Welcome back to another episode of Follow Time with De'Meco and Blair, a podcast where dads talk about balancing fatherhood, relationships, careers, and passions. I'm De'Meco, the resident dad to a wackadoo toddler, and this week, baby girl met her hero. Well, I don't want to say hero, but she met Bluey.
Oh!
That was kind of dope.
Hold on,
in her eyes, it might be her hero. I don't know.
She was like, oh, whoa, the motherfucker that's been on my TV is in the flesh? Exactly. Hold on now. Yeah, that's probably like a very revealing moment for her, dog. That's wild. How did you feel
meeting
Bluey? Because Bluey's like your hero down there.
It was an interesting interaction, and we can get into it. But like, she was a little shell shock. It was the first instance where she was around a big group of people. And so there were those moments where she would kind of venture off as like the experience allowed for her to like like sensory stuff and just play around and be around with other kids. But when she noticed she was too far away from us, like she kind of like got a little scared, and you could tell like as a toddler would, they would pull up their shirt and like fiddle with them, like their clothing, because they're anxious, they're feeling stress. And I saw her look around to find us, and I was like, it made me feel good. Like, she obviously feels safe with us. This is her safe space. So yeah, it was just really interesting to see. Like, that was probably the most people that she had been around in a long time, in a kind of a close quarters, you know. Yeah, very interesting. Very interesting to see her in that space. Like, she looked around and she's like was standing next to a person that wasn't her papa. And she's like, no, this ain't it. I gotta go. Exactly.
That's not my black tall man. Let me find one of mine.
Hey. But it was good.
That's awesome, bro. And I'm going to play party host of the most, your country cousin, Blair, a.k.a. Sir Winnie, father to the 8-year-old who is now a part of a girls-only track club that her school started. So shout out to the elementary middle school here in town that kind of put that together. And she's excited, bro. Like, the first thing she told me about it was like, she's like, daddy, I get to show people how fast I am. And I was like, that's what's up. But like, you know, it's not about being fast. It's about like getting better. And she was like, yeah, but I'm fast and I'm faster than they are. And I was like, that's my nick.
I don't think you have any idea how fast I really am. I'm fast as fuck, boy.
I'm fast as fuck, boy.
She was like, yeah. Wait, no, she was like, my nigga, I'm fast as shit, though. Let me show you real quick. And that's one thing Penelope is, like, has always. And Goose, when you watch this later on, like, you'll know. Like, you've always said how fast you are. Or that you want to be fast. So, to see that she's getting into track after we got her into soccer, it's pretty cool. And right now she's like really into like Get Air, which is like the little trampoline house. So gymnastics is down the pipeline as well. But all that to say, my dog is mad creative, and she's like stepping out of her realm. It's kind of like the opposite of the feeling or thought that you had when you saw Mayari in that room of people with Bluey. Like, I remember being in that spot and seeing Penelope not freeze up. But you can kind of see that, like, their feet get stuck in the sand. And and you are safety. But you can't really do things. It was like you're behind, like, that barrier at, like, a daycare center or, like, a tumble house or some shit. And it's like, yo, I have to be invisible right now, but I want to help you out. So this is a weird position to be in as a parent when you're a fly on the wall.
Yeah, literally.
But watching her grow into the position that she's in now, to where as a father, I look back, or as I'm on the opposite side of the fence, watching her interact with other kids, I feel a sense of like pride, because she's not nervous. Like, she is my kid. She's a social butterfly. Like, nigga talks. So that really just makes me smile on the inside and the outside, because I'm like, oh, I know she's good. Like, she'll be able to work rooms, and I want that to happen.
It's really interesting to watch your child process.
Exactly.
And that's what I was noticing, like, and stress or anxiety may be the wrong word, but that's just what I saw on my daughter's face. Like, she was like, wait a second, this isn't normal. There are more people around me. But you could see that she was calculating. And that for her, for a child her age, that is playtime. She's trying to figure out where she fits in. Mm-hmm. And so it's just really interesting to see. And I'm in this weird space with Mayari as a dad. Like, I've seen a lot of videos about people talking about, oh, like, as a parent to a toddler, you're always looking forward to the next stage. Like, oh, when are you going to take your first steps? Or when are you going to start eating solid food and all that? And then looking back, you're like, holding on to those moments. So like, don't grow up too fast type of thing. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, I'm seeing that on social media. And so it's forcing me to like be more present with Mayari now. And I'm like, oh man, you've come a long way. Like, I remember you learning how to sit up on your own for the first time to now you're standing up, trying to swing your leg over that crib. Like you, like we're getting ready for that toddler bed stage. And so I'm like, man, like you're growing up, and it's so crazy to see, to the point, like just this week, I'm seeing her, like we're just sitting on the couch watching Bluey as we're known to do.
Yes.
And I just kick back on the couch and I put my feet up and I look over and she does the exact same thing in the same. So I'm like, I'm noticing her pick up on my mannerisms in the moment. And I'm like, oh wow. Like obviously it magnifies the impact that I know I have on her, because I'm like, all right, well now she's watching, she's in that mimic stage. And so now I got to be more careful. Like, she probably shouldn't hear me say the word nigga because she can't get away with it.
She's kind of bright. She's fair skinned. Yeah. I don't know how.
There's a character on Bluey whose name is Snickers. And I'm like, that's going to be a tough one to say. It's going to be a tough one.
They say kids are familiar with that. And Australia is so nice. They're like, oh, we didn't mean anything by it, Mike.
Yeah, exactly.
We're just saying exactly. Snickers. The Snickers, Mike. It's like,
so close. It's so close.
Yeah, he almost got me. No, Michael, I got a question real quick, because
let's go.
This is kind of how I want to know how you feel about this and how other parents feel about this, because I am a overthinker. And when you were talking about like how you viewed Mayari processing the emotions or her feelings during playtime and seeing where she fit in, how did you feel more than what you were just saying? Like, did you feel that moment of like, I hope my kid is cool, I hope people like my kid, is she gonna be the weird one, is she gonna be the kid that like is in left field? Is, because that's like where my mind goes, like when sure. like when I see Penelope in moments, I'm like, all right bro, like do I helicopter parent right now and like tell her the type of people she should be hanging out with, or like, hey, this group might not be the group for us right now, because you can like I can read the body language of these kids and you can't, like you don't got it yet. Like, so how did you go about that, or are you even at that super overthinking processing point in your life?
Bro you already know I'm there.
I know you are. That's why I asked you that.
I live in that space of overthinking and overanalyzing, and I've seen a couple of videos that talk about the difference between like helicopter parenting and then snowplow parenting, which is like clearing the path of obstacles for your kid, which sounds good and it feels good as a parent, but like you're doing a disservice to your child because you're not allowing them to make those connections or make those processes in their head, and in life. So, looking at her process her emotions and process where she fits into playtime. I'm not quite there where it's like, hey, maybe don't go over there with those people. Like, I mean, she's a kid, especially in that setting. I think it's obviously it's based on the setting. I knew I didn't need to protect her. I knew I needed to provide her that space to have safe fun. But that doesn't stop me from thinking like, I'm not worried about my kid being the weird kid. I hope she's the weird kid. I know she's going to be the weird kid. But and I guess the way that I define that, I think the weird kid is like the kid that does like down the road is the one that's most sure of himself, sure of themselves, you know?
Yes.
Like, I think it's important as a parent to not nip things in the bud that may stifle your child's overall personality. Like, obviously, if something is going to do her harm, then obviously that's my job to protect her. Yeah. But if she's not going to do harm to herself or others, explore the world.
And that's, I think when I say like, I overprotect them in the weird sense, like, or thinking that my child is weird, I was considered like not the cool kid during the time that I was in middle school or high school. High school a little bit more, because like at that point I had known how to throw jokes at people. I was playing sports, so nobody really fucked with me that much. Like, I got fucked with. I had bad teeth and I was short, skinny. So you got picked on. But I had to know how to throw them back. With her, again, we live in Eugene, Oregon, so it's like the processing of prejudices, I would say, they start at this age, at her age, right? Mm. So like, I guess like the fear of weird where we're at in our stages of parenting are completely different, because like, I don't want her to feel like she's weird because of her hair or because of the way she talks or her skin or any of those things. Or, you know, like how it is for girls in comparison to boys. Girls' body changes. They don't feel comfortable with themselves. I don't know if my sister would be comfortable with me saying the exact time, but during the time that my sister was going through her body changes, my brother and I were fighting a lot because like we were defending our sister if ever someone made her feel some type of way. My daughter doesn't have anyone to sit and try and protect her or to hold her down on that. So it's like we have to, as the group that we are here, pretty much like set her up by joking with her at the crib to where she has easy comebacks, or she doesn't see jokes about her little skinny body or her hair, like, yeah, things like that. Like we have to make it like, in a sense, like not normalizing it here at the crib, but like, I have to give my daughter tougher skin because she's going to be a little girl. She's already super skinny. She's super tall. She's going to be a very pretty, tall, weird, goofy. She has my personality. So she's going to be a goof troop. So that's going to be her. So like, I don't want her to neglect her growth because society or her friendship group at that time deemed what she was doing weird in a way to where she shied herself. So like, that's where like, in my mind, I'm like, yo, we're not going to kick it with them kids right now. Like once you understand, what do you call that shit? When people are being assholes. Once you understand sarcasm and know how to give jokes back and forth, like then go out there and explore and be safe. But like for right now, I'm not even like snowplow parent or helicopter parent, because like we don't have any, like her friendship group is strictly motherfuckers that she goes to school with.
Yeah.
When she's kicking it with me, it's just me and her. Like, I don't have no homies who have kids around her age. She is the big cousin to everybody. So, so she's, in a sense, she's kind of stuck with that. So I don't know. I think that's where my mind goes to, like, maybe it's okay for her to get bullied or picked on. Cause then I can see how she reacts to it. But like, in a sense of being a protective parent, if I can negate that type of trauma and or self, like self-talk, like self-hate talk about yourself or self-questionable talk about yourself, like we're gonna get past all them goofy ass kids. Like, all right, what the
fuck? Yeah, I saw a video, I don't know who, I think Kate and I may have sent it to each other. The world is cruel enough as it is for young women, for young girls.
Yeah.
And so it is absolutely imperative as a parent to provide those young girls with all the compliments and all the love, because it may be the only place they hear it.
Yeah.
And I think there's so many different nuances in what you just said. I think it's about finding that balance of protecting your child, but also preparing your child.
Yeah.
Like, I think about what you just said, and it's different for young girls as it is for young boys or young men.
Like, could you just teach your son to throw hands? Like, yo, somebody says something that you don't like, fade them up.
Think about, like, I think about growing up, getting my hair cut. I was in a barber shop. You learned how to give and take.
That's your Spartan ring. That's what we spar in the barbershop.
And as soon as you talked about like you do that with Penelope, your group, your village, you're giving her reps of like, oh, I can give it back, or I'll, dad was just playing. Like it's not like dad called me, whatever. You may joke around with her. She's not all of a sudden throwing hands like, I will fight you. Like you're giving her that tough skin. You're giving her those reps. It's almost like when like my parents would say, all right, I'm going to need you to call and make your own doctor's appointment.
Yeah.
And like, they were there to walk me through it. You're just preparing your kid. But obviously you can't prepare them for everything. And that's when you see how they handle it. You see how they handle it when they get bullied. Cause kids are assholes. Your kid
built
could be
in dickheads.
Like, you know, like what I'm saying? Like your child could be getting straight A's and get made fun of for it.
Yep.
Your kid could be really into anime and get made fun of for it. Your kid could be into golf.
Get made fun of. You could be into basketball. You could be into the most popular thing or the unpopular thing and be made fun of. Like, kids are dickheads. So like that part is fully understood. It's just, I don't know. I guess like from being a kid who was picked on and wanting to have the friendships and have the conversations, like I'm trying to protect her from that. But she's also the cool kid because she has what most people don't have. And I think that's like where my insecurities as a young man came in, where I'm like, as I'm talking to you about it and as we're going through this, my insecurities of like, oh, well, I can't, but not can't, I don't want to do these things because like I've never had the OG to teach me or this and that. But for her, it's like she has a dad and a stepdad. She has a mom and a stepmom to help give her four different views of whatever one scenario she's going through. So I feel like with that, we kind of hit the gold mine, like, and I am just setting her up for success by preparing her, by joking her, and by like walking her through these things.
I think, yeah, I mean, yeah, kids will be assholes. Kids will be bullies. My biggest thing is I just want to make sure Mayari is not one of them. Like,
man, yeah,
that's probably my biggest thing is that I want to make sure that Mayari is present enough to see the world can be both ways, you know, like don't be an asshole. Like just, you can be dope as hell and not be an asshole. Like, you know, like just because your friends are making fun of this. Yeah. Like
you say, yeah, just say, yeah, to go along with it.
We over here trying to raise Michelle Obama's. When they go low, we go high. You over here like, nigga, no, be petty.
No, when they go low, we go to hell. Nah, you hear me?
When they go low, you go to Uncle Blair.
You go to Uncle Blair. Oh, so you finally come to see the ways of the master, huh?
Oh my God.
Fuck it around.
But yeah, I think that's probably the most important thing that Kate and I have is like, we want to raise a daughter that is compassionate, because if you can't take it, then don't dish it out. And that's always been my thing, is like, I've never been, even when like it got until just recently, within like, let's say the last 5 years, I wasn't really big on shit talking on the golf course.
Yeah,
just because I'm like, you just never know whose game is going to show up, and I'm like, I don't want to have to back that up, you know? And so I'm just like, you know what? I've never been a shit talker. I've never been one to like make fun of people or anything like that. I'm like, yo, you having fun? Cool. All right. I'm having fun too. Let's go.
It's hard because I played football and basketball more growing up. Not saying that you didn't, but like basketball and football and being smaller, me having the gift of gab was my advantage. So in the golf space, I'm more hesitant to talk shit because I'm out here golfing with random sometimes, or people who I'm like, hey, let's build a relationship to get golf going. Not saying that I'm gonna be fake when we like, as we become friends later on down the line. But with Kyle, like, Kyle understands now my humor, but if I was to shit talk Fish the first time I met him when we played golf, pretty sure cousin.
Y'all wouldn't be friends. Yeah, y'all would not be friends.
Nah, you know what I'm saying? Especially because my game didn't match it. Like, so you just ass and you talk shit?
You an asshole. You just an
asshole. Yeah, at that point, you're Patrick Beverly. You can't be Patrick Beverly of golf. I'm only saying that because that's clickbait. Pat, come on the show, bro. We want you on.
Yeah, yeah, Chicago,
that's,
stand
that's a,
up.
That's a West Side Gunner. No, so like, but I think that it's best to, like you said, prepare your children to, like, the world is not cookies. You know what I'm saying? Fortunately, your daughter is going to be raised on the South Side of Chicago, so she's going to have a built-in layer.
Yeah, she's gonna get her reps more. In. She's gonna get her reps in.
There's gonna, and she is going to be the definition of Time Magazine 2050. They said by 2050, the world is going to be a bunch of mixed people, right? Mayari is going to be that one mixed girl that before you question something, like if she says nigga, just by like the off chance she does it, like her tone and like some of her body features are going to be like, let's run a DNA scan.
All right. Nice.
1/8 black.
Afternoon, my octoroon. Come on, bring it in there. Tuck that.
I'm in there, dog.
You tucking it in there? But you tucked though. You tucked
up. I'm in there. You cut him in there. I'm in there.
All right. Nice to meet you, man. Nice to meet you.
She said this before, and she got away. Like,
the way
she
you said it before, said it,
and she knew it was okay to do it.
The way you said it was not timid. You didn't. Yeah. You didn't VH1 say the N word. You BET said the N word. So you, where your daddy from?
You Southside Chicago said the N word. Yeah, that's what you're.
You're not from Gary. You from the Southside. Southside. All right. Yeah. Cool. So I wanted to get into, I'm glad that we had that. And literally, bro, we were talking about this, I think on Tuesday. I was like, what if you like a topic? He was like, I got two videos on the show, but those can turn into a conversation. You know how we are.
Yeah.
This is how we are. But I wanted to get into our newest segment, whenever it is, myself and my brother going at our podcast episodes together. We have D'Amico's unsung fictional father. I don't know what we're going to name this. Like, whatever.
I don't, yeah.
We got to figure out a
fictional father flowers. I don't know what we're going to call it. I like the alliteration, but just, you know.
The fictional father that you really wouldn't hear people talk about in the last. The
honorable mentions.
Yeah.
Honorable mentions.
It's not even honorable mentions yet. It's just probably somebody hasn't named them yet. But in the last 23 episodes that we've had, no one said it. So now we got something for you. D'Amico, who do you have for this week's unsung hero fictional father?
As we talked about this before, I got a lengthy list of people that I just want to just blurt out right now, so it was hard to figure out which one I was gonna say. I coming into this conversation, I honestly had two in my head. The one I'm going to mention mm-hmm. isn't even one of the two that I was thinking about mentioning, because I was like, oh, man, I saw something that sparked it, and I was like, I have to say this one.
Okay.
I have to say this one, because I'm like, I wanted to bring some new dads in, like maybe some newer pop culture references, because obviously everything we mentioned is always very nostalgic. Yeah. So I'm going nostalgic because it's just iconic. He doesn't get enough credit in the world that he lives in. And I'm talking our man, Mr. Goofy.
Morning, son. Dad. Oops. I forgot.
Okay.
The whole movie of a Goofy movie is basically him just trying to be a good dad. A single dad.
And he's the definition of a single dad. We've never seen a Mrs. Goofy. This nigga's doing it by himself.
With a teenager. Because you know Max Goofy is like, man.
He's 17. After going today, to college.
After today, I'm trying to go see Powerline. I'm trying to holler at Roxanne.
I'm trying to make sure Roxanne see this Powerline. You feel me?
Nigga trying to stand out. Okay.
I'm trying to stand up and out. Shout out, you know. Let me stop. What the fuck are we doing right now, bro? That's a kid's movie.
But it's an adult podcast.
Hey. No, I think I think when you talk about Goofy, I think we might have brought this up just in passing before this conversation or before this segment became a thing. When you think about Goofy, he really has, he has a teenage son that is trying his hardest to get away from the house. He wants so hard not to be like his dad, to be as far away from his dad as possible. And you have that father who understands, and this is tough because as I'm saying this in my head before I say it out loud, like it's punching me in the chest, that Goofy understood that the opportunities and chances that parents get to see their adult children once they leave the house are few and far between. So Goofy was trying to do whatever he could to hold on to memories. That's why he had little Maxie when he was like looking at all the old pictures, like Maxie, like all that shit. He really was
alphabet holding, soup.
Yeah, he was holding on to memories that right now De'Meco and I are making. So damn, that's hard, bro, because he really did. And if you think about it, like the song that Tevin Campbell sung is
Eye to Eye.
Yeah, Eye to Eye is literally a father and son song. That's like a parenting song. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say father and son. I'm not trying to hold that for us, but that's a parenting song.
Yeah. And it's a father son, it's a father child song just because of the movie context. But mm-hmm. Yeah, it is a parental song.
Literally, I'm singing it in my head, bro. Like I ain't trying to get DMCA. I'm gonna just play it right now, bro. But like who cares? In the clip, like roll the footage. Yeah, man, like that is like if we listen to each other's heart, like bro, I mean, what?
You're about to break out in song real quick.
No, I had to stop. We already just played the video. They might strike us. This might be the first video we're gonna strike on.
Dad, show them the perfect cast. And I mean that movie, that's up there. With Lion King and that Mufasa, yeah. Like I'm going to get a power line tattoo. Like Tevin Campbell, like that was iconic in that time. Like we talk about like movies that weren't black movies, but you kind of think it's a black movie. That's Goofy a black movie. Black.
Goofy's black.
Yeah, bro.
Goofy's yes. Black. Also, yeah. Fun fact: I went to Disney for my wife and our honeymoon a couple years back, and as we're leaving, they got all the characters out doing the little shit. And I see Goofy like on the street. And then the dog or whatever, Pluto is up top. And I was like, hey, I've always wanted to know this because as a kid, I thought Goofy was a dog. So I was like, how can Goofy the dog talk and Pluto the dog can't talk? And the Disney lady literally like looked left and right as if she was giving me the biggest piece of like secretive information that Walt Disney himself told her. And she was like, so here's the thing. Goofy is a cow and Pluto's a dog. And I was like, you show me one cow right now with long ass ears and I'll believe you.
There. Yeah.
I will fight you in here, Disney lady.
But you know, Goofy got a long nose though. Like it, like there's a whole, like there is a cow. Like you've seen the, like it's the cow that always hangs out with Daisy.
Yes, there's a cow in the show and you have her depicted as a cow.
Yeah, vastly different. Vastly different.
I think they were just trying to get me out of there because they smelled the liquor in my breath. I was like, hey, let me talk to you.
Yeah. This is a place for children.
Sir, you can't smoke weed in here. Walt told me it was okay. Listen.
I don't see a sign. You got to have a sign.
There's actually mad signs in that motherfucker right before you get in. If you have any substances, please throw them away or put them in your car. And I was like, babe, you think I can get my weed pen in here? She's like, please don't. And I was like, shh, don't tell me.
That's why you bring a can of Wink.
Hey, whenever that happens. Whenever that Wink ad happens. No, what we did, like, what I had, and I didn't know that this was a thing, like, you can't have like extended things like GoPro sticks or
like selfie sticks.
Yeah, right. So you can't have those in there. And I took my GoPro because I'm like, why the fuck not? Like, I've never been to Disney. I'm about to go crazy. And I was like literally talking to cousins up front. I was like, bro, I just bought this is a $50 like extender. And we came here on a bus, like a shuttle bus from the hotel. Like, y'all can't just hold this up here for me. It's like, no, we can't do that. You got to throw it away or like you can't come in, blah, blah, blah. And found out, A, didn't have to tell them or show him that I had that. B, they can hold them until you get out of the fucking outside the park. And see, it was just like, don't say a fucking thing to these people, bro. Just walk right in. Like, tell them that you have. They can't check your shit. But you can just, like, open it up and say, I ain't got nothing there.
Forgiveness, not permission.
Yeah. From the next day when I went in, I took off all the weed in the world. I had so many gummies. I was high as shit, and then we went to the Marble campus. First thing we went on was, like, the Tower of Terror, but now it's called Guardians of the Galaxy. So it's the one that goes all the way up and drops and shit.
Yeah.
I had never been on a roller coaster day in my life, cause like ever been on a roller coaster.
Pass. Until
it's so fun. Pass. So I think about that shit daily, nigga. I get on the elevator, I'm like, I wonder if this bitch just dropped real quick and then stopped before we got to first floor. Like
adrenaline junkie over here.
Hey, nigga, I was not at first. I mean, I couldn't say I wasn't. I was in the military. Like, I'm definitely an adrenaline junkie. Like, I like the shit. But like, I've never been like, hey, let's do extreme white people stuff. Like, that's never been my thing. And the first thing my wife
don't ever said, ask me to go, don't ask me to go bungee jumping. That's too close to
lynching, something, nigga.
That's very close. That's that is, too close.
That's intimate close. Death. So you want me to hang myself while y'all
I'd
cheer?
I'd rather skydive. Blair, if you could ask your, because it's father time, if you could ask your dad, like, what's one question you wish you could ask him and get the answer to? Now, obviously, I'm not him. We can't get that. But what's that one question, that burning question that you wish you could get an answer to from your dad?
What's crazy is I've asked this question and I've gotten no answer. So, and the two times that I have talked to him, so I kind of already know what his answer is going to be every time I ask a question. but I guess the simplest and most important question is, how could you know you had a child and didn't do anything to be in his life? Knowing how hard the world is for a black man, knowing how hard it was for you, easiest question to ask Walter is why that? Like, why it took you so long to try? And then follow-up question, just because I'm a dickhead, what was your reasoning for legitimately not trying? Was it because Dion was in the equation? Was it because you felt like I had already hit a point in time in my life that I didn't need a dad? Whatever it is, like, at this point, I couldn't care less about you as a human being. So it's not like I'm looking for an explanation, like I'm still 8 or 9 waiting on the porch or crying about you as I'm 13. At this point, it's just a burning question. Being a dad to a kid, me and my daughter being separated from each other for a while, I went broke, went into debt, took all the money out of the savings, ripped the credit card to make sure that I could see my kid. And that nigga was 30 minutes away. So how you couldn't do it with resources, with time. Like, and that's the thing. Like, if it was a resources thing, like if you didn't know how to explain yourself, at this point in my life, I am okay with whatever answer you give me. Just the lame ass excuse that you are blaming my mom is to me, that's lame as shit. That's the weakest, lowest of fruits that you could try and grab because I could be wrong. Somebody in the comment section could tell me, but my mom never once negatively spoke about Walter. like, as I got older and he no longer wanted to show who he was, I had to ask questions and get answers from somewhere. But she never negatively talked about Cuz. Everything was what happened as a fact, because you got arrested for a lot of the stuff that happened. So it is public record. So a lot of the facts that are public record, my mom told me about. So I just want your side of the story, OG. And then I want my 60 seconds. We from the same gang. Let me get my 60 seconds after that and we good. I wash my hands of you. But he's a coward. And he will go to his grave blaming my mom for doing everything, his quote, everything she could to make sure we didn't see each other. That's what he says. My mom didn't force you to kill anybody. My mom didn't force you to not show up when you did get released. It's a lot of things my mom didn't do. And talking shit about you was one of them. But the one thing she did do, and I think this is where the anger and the emotion probably comes in, is my mom did get us winter coats whenever we fucking needed it in the harsh winters that Tennessee did have when we lived there. My mom did make sure, although we didn't have the greatest of shit, we got the 2 for $99 from Finish Line. So we had two different pairs of shoes for the beginning of school, and then we did the same thing at Christmas time. So we have 4 shoes each year for school. There was never a time where we wanted to play a sport, go to an event. We worked for it because she worked for her shit, but there was never not a time my mom didn't do that. She also got 3 degrees, including Master Stylist and Barber license. While being a single mom, working, she was working while we were at school. She came home long enough to take care of us, make sure we did homework, and then she went to work again, and then did school all in between online. So I know what my mom did do. Showing up was the biggest one. So a lot of people probably have thoughts about guys who were raised by their moms. And the view of like what moms do. I don't know what they mama be doing, but Darlene, solid. And my kid's mom is solid. Because my child's mother has never once, at least from my POV, said anything negative about me around our daughter. I'm the greatest man in the world to her. And I don't know why she thinks that. And I love her to death. So shout out to Darlene, my mommy, and shout out to Penelope's mom, Hannah. I love both y'all. Strong ass, solid ass women.
That's huge.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I think that's important. I look back at my experience when my parents split up. I don't know why my dad was convinced that my mom was bad mouthing him or anyone was bad mouthing him. You know, like my mom never bad mouthed my dad. And made sure I didn't either. Like if I said something out of line, she's like, no, that's your father. You respect your father.
Yeah. See,
Like our experiences obviously with our dads are different. My dad was in the picture. So like, yeah, my dad never didn't show up. He didn't show up in different ways.
Yes. It's the same. It's the same thing, but not the same. Yeah. Cause I know a lot of the homies whose dad was there, but wasn't there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So like,
yeah.
And I think that's where I kind of feel like I miss out? Question mark. I wouldn't even say really. Yeah, really. No, really. But like, did I really miss out? Because he could have just been a piece of shit person. And then if my dad and my mom stay together, do I get my little sister? If my dad and my mom stay together with his gang ties and with his quick temper, does he kill my mom in front of me and my brother? Like, do I have my mom now? Like, it's so many ifs that could come from that.
Yeah.
And the biggest if is, or the biggest question mark here, sorry to cut you off, is if this nigga was around, his influence on me would have been blank. And I know a nigga who, I know a person who I don't want to be like. He is him.
I think with that kind of piggybacking off of that, I think it goes to show like individually who you are and who I am is you've got people that like, oh, I want to be just like my dad. And for a long time I did. And then I kind of grew up, and not to say like my dad isn't a bad guy, but I'm like, I saw what his faults were, and I'm like, oh, I don't want that. And so I think back to the things that I didn't get out of my dad, how that has positively impacted the way that I'm a dad to Mayari. And I think I'm like, all right, for that, I'm thankful, because if on the surface it felt all hunky dory, I may not be trying as hard as I am right now in fatherhood. I don't want to speak for you, but in my head, that's how I view you right now. It's like, I'm going to be there. Penelope won't ever not see me at school, at lunch, or whatever. Like, we are going to be there.
Nigga ain't gonna be able to have a podcast talking about how her daddy went there. Fuck that.
Exactly. Exactly.
That nigga's podcast gonna be like, yo, I hate the fact that my daddy is still alive and kicking it, because he's goofy as fuck, he's annoying as hell, and he's our next guest. So shout out to my dad for never leaving the
studio. Yo.
Yeah, that's me. You know what I'm talking
that
about?
That would like, be lit.
Like, that's just how I see myself as a parent. Like, do I want to be the corny dad? Do I want to be the dude who has a dad jokes? Do I want to be the guy that people come to when their best, or who my daughter's friends come to when their dad isn't in the picture, or stepdad is doing something? Like, do I want to be that protective father figure? Fuck yes. Is that my number one goal as a dad? You're goddamn right. What am I doing to make sure that I am that person? It's putting in reps. Like, I now having the 8-year-old daughter who's going to be coming to me about things when she's 10. My wife told me about the time that she first found out that she was going to be having a period. My daughter's mom, my sister, that shit is so close to being a reality for my black ass. It's not even funny. So there's that aspect that comes into the fact of being a parent. So there's so many different things that I need to be putting in reps for right now, to where I'm not questioning, I'm not judging, I'm not jumping too much in. Do I do those things? Yes, because it's a knee-jerk reaction I want to fix. It's in my brain. It's how I'm wired. Oh, something happened? I got it. I'm going to figure it out on the way to that situation. But you obviously came to me with this for a reason. I got it. Let me figure it out as we walk. But I got to be able to take steps back and not want to fix shit, because sometimes, and my wife has let me know this, nigga, you can't fix that. Like, just listen. Sometimes you got to just close your mouth, Blair, and just listen. Because I'm not a therapist. I'm a barber. I'm a podcast
For some people, that's a therapist.
For the homies, that's a therapist. For your wife and daughter, sometimes them niggas just need to shut the fuck up and listen. Not your head real good. So, you know. I'm practicing.
What does Ted Lasso say? Sometimes girl talk is girl listen.
Yeah, girl that's listen. Yeah. Yeah,
that's all it is. I'm very curious, because obviously we're both going to go down that path. Obviously, you are 8 years ahead of me. What's that thought process like for you as a dad, knowing that that's coming down the line? Obviously, I've seen a lot of videos talking about the differences of what that is nowadays. Like, back when we were at that age where girls our age were going through that, it was just the pad. Now there are obviously other things that can happen. There are certain chemicals, because like, they're putting something in their body, and I'm just like, oh snap, like there's a lot more to learn and to think about being a single dad in this situation. And going at it alone, I would know, like, I'm not that I'm uncomfortable being in the female hygiene part of the aisle. I'm not.
Oh, yeah.
But like, you don't know what do they need? I'm like, yeah, I would be.
That's when it's girl lesson.
Exactly.
You tell me what to pick up from the store. I'm not. This ain't a me. I'm not helping you shop at this point. You tell me what to pick up.
Not even that.
If it's not there,
everything.
One of everything. You're
coming home with one of everything. Let's see what works.
Hold on. For our listeners, I am about to chug 4 fingers of rye whiskey before I answer this question. Okay. That shit hurts. What is that thought process like? Again, like I told you earlier in this conversation, me and my brother beat a nigga up at the pool for making fun of my sister. Stumped that nigga the fuck out. I'm pretty sure he might remember us. He might have like vendettas if he's listening to this. Fuck you, nigga, still. Yeah, cuz made fun of my sister. So we packed his ass out like real quick. Simple as that. So again, she doesn't have a big brother or even a little brother or a big cousin or an equated cousin. So I get sweaty hands. I get nervous because I, again, like the female anatomy in that sense, I've not, like, I still get questioned about, like, I'm, everything's not for everybody and that's okay. You know what I'm talking about? Like, I don't want to know that part of the female body. That way, you dig? Like, I'm good. Like, I know a few things about women. I know that you are born with every single baby that you could possibly have, you're born with. That is a strong, crazy thought to have. And also, you are wounded for 7 days and you live. Like, pints of blood are coming out of you and you still have to, like, for athletes, play a sport, or for moms, like, still have to wake up with cramps and do shit. So, like, I get a headache and my day is done. Like, I'm I get debilitating migraines because, like, I break down. I cry off of migraines because, like, if my daughter came to me and was like, yo, daddy, like, I'm cramping. I don't want to go to school. Cool, my nigga. We not going to school. So in that world, like, I don't know what to do. So anything that you want to do until Hannah and Alma tell me I'm wrong and we got to do it this way. And Blair, you got to stick to this. Like, whatever Penelope wants to do. Like you said, we buy one of everything until one of them comes home and they tell us what's right. And then from then on, daddy has it in the notes section. I know what to get you every time I go to the store. I don't know what I'm doing. And this is the part of fatherhood that I don't know what I'm doing. So for the dads who have the daughters who are a bit older, or for the moms or the aunts or the cousins that are listening right now, and you guys can give myself and De'Meco advice. Like, although we do have our own partners, like, the more the merrier. All types of advice is welcome on this topic because I am confused. I don't know what I don't know. And again, I don't want to know.
Sure.
That's a you thing, mama. So yeah, scared is how I feel. I had to drink liquor to get that whole part of the conversation out because I have a graphic memory. All right, I have a graphic mind. So, like, so as I'm thinking of this, I'm like, oh, my daughter at school when it happens, my daughter walking when it happens, or her on the bus when it happens, or her at get air when it happens, her with her friends when it happens. And I'm like, okay, we get the, I'm hopping in the Jeep. It's a track hawk now. We going 100 miles per hour to wherever you're at. And then, I don't know, are you embarrassed enough to where we got to move? I don't know what this feels, bro. Like, I don't know what to feel. Yeah. Do I save up money just in case we got to go to another school? Are we homeschooling now? Like, I don't know, bro. Hey, hold on real quick before you guys move on any further in the episode. Just want to let you guys know that we appreciate you all for tuning in. You could have been anywhere in the world, but you decided to watch and or listen to our podcast. Right now, take the time to like, share, subscribe. Give us a follow, leave some comments, all that good jazz. De'Meco and I would fucking love it. Make sure that you leave us a follow on all social media platforms at Father Time Pod. That way that you guys are more insightful on the things that we got coming, whether that be merch, fantasy football things, and or new guests that we might have down the pipeline. You never know, we might have like Lamorne or Schoolboy Q one of these days. So yeah, I might be able to help out with that. So get y'all back to the episode. I love you guys, man. Make sure to tell somebody you love them. Peace.
That's really interesting. So I want to know. Like, obviously, ain't nobody going to know my daughter's body better than her. But, like, how do you create that space that it's normal, it's natural? So I'm like, she's going to be learning about her body. I'm like, oh, well, I'm not going to be an expert, but hey, I can be a sense and source of calm in that situation. But I remember the first time I changed her diaper and I looked at Kate, I'm like, whoa, I knew my daughter was a girl, but I just like the shell shock of changing the first diaper, and I'm like, whoa. Without getting overly graphic, but I'm like, there's discharge from like as a newborn. I'm like, mm-hmm. I'm wiping too. I'm like, am I wiping too hard? It's not coming. I'm like, I'm over here. Like, yeah, I was losing it. But yeah, it's really interesting to think about. I'm almost drawn to going back to this time in my life of packing a spare set of clothes all the time. I don't know how I deliver that message to Mayari of like, hey, all right, here's your backpack with your school supplies, your lunchbox, and also a change of clothes. Dad, why do I need a change of clothes? Just in case, like, how do you prepare her for that without projecting anxiety? You know,
I think God willing, as long as moms are around, that is something that dad should not have to touch. And I get that you want to be able to like help her walk through that process. But my mom gave me this advice, and my kid's mom gave me this advice when we were having Penelope, and I was having this conversation with her. First time I changed Penelope as well. She was like, certain things aren't for you to be able to explain.
Mm.
So it kind of like, it's not the same, but it kind of goes into the fashion of Penelope being mixed and her mom being white. Penelope saying the N-word at her house, her mom not knowing exactly how to explain to her how, why, and that you're not really, like, you can say, but you can't say it. So it was a weird place for Hannah to be in.
Sure.
The only person that had knowledge of that in particular situation, it was the black dad. So
that's a great, great comparison. You know what I'm saying? That sits with me now.
Yeah.
That
so for dads, it's like, yeah, we want to be able to help fix shit and like help you get through this process. But like, you can't say nigga at that point. And if you did, you'd be looked at weird. So let the people who can say nigga say nigga. Let the people who can do. Until Kate gives you that knowledge. Like if Kate walks you through it to where like, hey, with kid gloves, this is the way that you are to speak to our daughter during this time. Like once Kate gives you the game plan, then you go through that. And as a dad, as men, as we do, we try and add our own flavor to it every once in a while, and we're gonna fuck up. Then you know how to tweak it. All right, that was a little too far. Bring it back in. There's a comedian, or hold on, you had something. I can remember this part. You were about to say something.
I had nothing.
Okay.
I was basically gonna say like, oh, so this is the equivalent of Kate being able to say nigga, but it's not nigga. It's talking about a period. That's what I was gonna say. Yeah. I had really nothing.
Kate holds the cards in the N-word department.
Yeah.
In that one.
But also Kate, don't say the N-word.
Please. Come on, Snoop. Don't. I'll fuck with you, Snoop. I don't want to have to cancel you.
Yeah, we can't get canceled.
I thought this nigga got us canceled this morning.
Right. That was so fun. I told Kate about that. She's like, that's wild.
I was so like, all those people, shout out to y'all. But no, it's kind of like Brett Kreischer, however the fuck you say his name. Fat comedian who always takes his shirt off at all his stand-ups. He was talking about how he has two daughters, and his wife kind of brought it up to him like, this is how we're going to go through this. So for his first daughter, after like, I guess like the first few times, they celebrated it with like a cake. So it's like a party. So you guys like celebrate it however you want, bring your friends over. It's like a period party. He said that his youngest daughter named her period Jason, because she has a sense of humor. And he's like, she invited all her homegirls over, and then her one like male friend, and her male friend did not know. No, the guy friends, he didn't know what he was there for. And they're like celebrating Jason, which is the name of her period. So the little boy's like, so when's Jason coming out? And it's like, I don't know if you want to be around when Jason comes out, bro. Go on.
Go home.
Go home, Roger.
This party ain't for you, kid.
This part of the party is not for you. They brought him here strictly to, like, horrify. And Bert, if you're listening to this, come on to the podcast, and you can tell this joke better than I did because it's your story. But yeah, that when I saw that, I was like, there's ways that you can handle this as a dad. But mom has to be the one who sets the, like, mom has to, like, drive the ground. She has to, like, engineer the path line. All that. That has to be mom. That's all mom does.
Yeah.
Because if we do it, we'll fuck it up. I've seen.
Yeah, she mom's got to be the OC. She got to be the offensive coordinator.
On I'm just a quarterback coach. You heard what she said, all right? On two, yeah, let's go. Break.
I am not a quarterback. I am special teams. That she. I'm the assistant coach that's always trying to hold their coach inside of the sideline. All
right, that's the get back coach. Yeah. You're the get back coach.
I'm the get back coach. I'm the get back coach.
No, yeah. Zinni said that she wants that job. She was like, I would love to just do that. Just get paid to just pull a grown man backwards.
I feel like that's what wives kind of do. Yo, you reel it back in. Reel it back in.
She's
you going too far.
She's
you going too
had
far.
Had to pull my dumbass back in, and this was all before we got married. I don't know why she actually stayed with me, bro. Like, I was a fucking loose cannon, and she was just like, "That's my man."
So, that is a perfect segue to this video. We're going to shout out the wives, our better halves, the people that have given us the space to do what we're doing right now.
I say this all the time, man, but like, I need my wife.
Mm-hmm.
I need my wife.
Yeah.
And I don't ever want that to be confused nowhere. Mm. So much of who I am is because of who my wife has been in my life.
Mm.
It's because of who you've been in my life. You have given me everything that I need to have the desire and the drive and all of that stuff developed in me to want to be able to become more, to do more, to be more intentional, to give a little bit more effort, to show up better for myself and in the world and all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, you contributed to a lot of that. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that being with you, and that's how you've contributed to me being able to learn a lot of the lessons that I've learned as a man, as a husband, as a father.
Mm-hmm.
I've gotten a lot of that stuff just from us being together.
Right.
Like, I wouldn't have learned these things had you not been there.
Mm-hmm.
So I give you all that credit because you created a space for me to be able to learn that stuff and to grow in those ways.
Yes.
Like that's what my wife does for me. That's what my spouse, my partner, my best friend, that's what she does for me. That's what you have done for me. For years.
I mean.
Yeah.
I feel that with all of me.
Hell yeah, Kyle. Man, so. for me, bro, it's I have a post that I had a while back, I think. Where it was Allen Iverson, where he was just like, I mean, I need my wife. Yeah, like legit in the video, he was like, I need her. I can't live with her. I can't live without her. Like, if she want to go to school, like she want to do shit, like going out the house and shit. Like I know she want to go to school, but like go to school online. Don't go out the house. Like, I need you here 24/7. Nigga, my world doesn't, like, my son is my daughter, but my world don't spin without Z. Like, my daughter's gonna end up growing up and growing out of the house. She's gonna have her own life to where I'm going to be a NPC that she visits. Hopefully I've done enough to where she visits me a lot, but like, I'll just be visited by her. So my wife and I's relationship is my job, right? Like, my wife is my world. I will find her when I come back around the sun again. Like, so when I die and get reincarnated, I'm finding her spirit all over again, because I'm gonna do it with her in every lifetime. That nigga's made me such a dope person. I would still be wanting to hit niggas in the face. I would be a felon with a pistol. Right now, I'm just a nigga with a gun. I would be a felon with a pistol if it wasn't for her. Like, man, the fuck out of here, bro. And when he's talking about, like, my best friend, my partner, my spouse, like, I started Onyclamedia with my best friend. If it wasn't for my best friend, I would not have started streaming. It wasn't for my best friend who gave me the confidence to be like, yo, you need to stop talking to yourself when you're gaming. Like, you're saying shit that's semi-funny. You're not that funny, but somebody might find you funny. So, like, talk to a camera while you playing the game.
You ain't that funny, but you kind of funny.
Yeah, exact words. Her exact words. Like, no bullshit. And you know it. Her exact words. She's like, you're not that funny, but I figure somebody might like what you're saying. So she got me a Mac. She got me the... she didn't know what else. At this point, she didn't know what she needed to get. She just knew to stream, you needed a webcam, a computer, and whatever gaming system you had. So she got me a Mac and a fucking webcam, and we built from there. So Onyclamedia is named after my daughter. It started, the thought, the idea, the game plan started in 2017, a year after Penelope was born. But 2019 is when we took off. That's Alma. That's my wife's doing. Because none of the homies wanted to do that. Like, when I was struggling and I needed to make sure that I, like, somebody... So when I just needed simple shit like, hey, yo, bro, could you pick me up from my job and drive me a mile away so I can go see my daughter real quick for scheduled visits, like court-ordered visits to see my kid? Like, can you drop me off? Niggas had excuses. Mm. This girl got off of work, would schedule her work day to make sure she was helping me get to where I needed to go. Bro, that's somebody who wants more for you than you want for yourself. The nigga made sure I ate at the base level. Call, hey, have you eaten? I'm good. I ain't actually good. I know you're good. But have you eaten something? Like, you're about to, I know you, you're about to walk to work. You're not going to ask anybody for a ride. So you're either going to scrounge up money to get on a bus or a taxi, or you're going to walk to work, burn all the little calories your skinny ass got. Like, have you eaten anything, bro? And she'll still do it to this day. Like, have you eaten? Like, we were late recording the podcast. Because, like, she saw I was working out a little bit. She was like, have you eaten today? No, I'm going to just hop in the shower real quick, wash my hair, and I'm, no, you're going to eat. I think De'Meco in that podcast can wait. If it's just y'all two, you need to eat. You're right. I do need to eat. Nigga, we was in Mexico. Baby, put some sunscreen on. I don't need no sunscreen. God touch my skin. You're going to get burnt. Put some sunscreen on. You're right. Nigga, that motherfucker knows what's best for me because she sees me in ways that I don't see myself, because I am always trying to do for other people. I'm always on for other people. So when you are always locked into pleasing or doing things for others, you neglect self. And the best partner, fuck the relationship, the sexual part, the best partner to have is someone who, if you pass the fuck out at the wheel, I can drive this motherfucker. De'Meco and I's co-host podcast relationship, our friendship is based off of that premise. If De'Meco can't fly the plane, I got this bitch. I got it in my hours. I can fly this motherfucker for you. And if neither one of us can fly it, y'all don't know this, it's autopilot, bro, because we already set up for weeks ahead. So it was autopilot. There'll never be a time when we can't fly this bitch. But like, if I can't do this shit in the house, I know my wife got. And if she can't, she know I got her. I am everything that she's not, and she's everything I'm not. We make each other whole. That is the reasoning for the yin and yang. Like, it she is everything I am not. I am not complete without her. I'm a father, yes. Penelope's always going to have her daddy. But Penelope's going to have a family one day. I'm not whole without that nigga. And y'all will know the day that she don't, the day that this ain't a thing, which y'all never know, because it'll never not be a thing. But when God takes her away from me, I think the day that if she goes and I'm not here, I'll be like my great granddad, and I'll go the second that she leaves. It'll be a month, because that's how long it took him. He was like, I can't be here no more. I don't want to be here. Nothing here gives me enjoyment. What's in that other room over there gives me the most enjoyment. Brings me the most joy. just being in her presence, nigga. No conversations, no words, nothing dull to break up the monotony of silence. This is us. And that's love to me. Like, that's my love in a bubble. Being able to just sit in the room, you on your phone, I'm watching bullshit on the TV, and we just here. I'm touching your foot every once in a while to get that physical touch to, like, remind you that I love you. Like, are we here? Yeah, cool. And I'm back to doing nothing, and you're back to doing nothing. So, yeah, the other day at work, and then Jessica said, and then, nah, get out of my face with that shit. Let me get tired. Real quick. Let's shut up and do nothing. She cool with me smoking. She cool with me talking my little shit whenever I go on my rants. She cool with me gaming. Like, every year she knows I'm buying 2K after I complain about how trash 2K is. We've been doing this shit since 2017.
Beautiful. Yeah, I feel the same way. I mean, I kind of talk about it in the episode with Ashton, talking about like what fatherhood means to me. And I mean, it's nothing without Kate. You talk about how Alma kind of takes care of you when you can't take care of yourself at whatever the point is. That's what Kate did for me. When I had my big falling out with my dad, and my dad basically said, and I was still in school at the time. That was one, another thing. Like, when we started dating, I was still trying to finish up school.
You tell me.
So I didn't have a job. I was making $75 working at the rec center at school.
And this nigga's trying to hang out with Kate all day.
And she done been working. She a tenured teacher with a master's degree. And I'm like, I don't know how I got it. I don't know. But I call her. My dad says, hey, well, you know what? If you love her so much and you think she loves you, go call her. See if you can go live with her. I'm like, don't call my bluff. I will call her right now and see, and we'll find out. And she got a rental car because she didn't have a car. I had just gotten a car. My dad just bought me a little 97 Pontiac Sunfire, little piece of shit car. A little classic with the roll up. It still had the roll up window.
Had the fucking manual window.
Yeah, for real.
Cassette
and
tape.
So because that car was bought with my dad's money, I'm like, I'm gonna leave that. I don't want any ties. You know what? Fuck it. I call Kate. I'm like, hey, can you come pick me up? And she's like, yeah, I got you. So she picked me up in the dark of the night. Midnight, I snuck out of my house and I packed up my little duffel bags and shit, and we moved in together into a single studio like apartment.
Enough for her. And she spoils you in.
And she And it was just it was everything. I mean, she has always been my safe space.
Yeah.
And I said it in our episode with Ash, and I will always be indebted, obviously, for her being able to provide me the journey of being a dad, but she has given me that space to be as confident as I am in myself right now that you see. Like, I'm not saying that you and I wouldn't be having this podcast, because I was always going to be on social media. I was always going to try to make connections. But you would have seen a different version of myself, not confident, unsure of himself, not really comfortable in my own skin. She's provided that space for me. And as goofy as I am and as modest as I can be, I'm still like, no, I know I'm hot shit to the people who it matters to. Like, Kate looks at me, she's like, D'Meco, I'm impressed, I'm proud of you, all that stuff. And I'm like, well, that's all the validation I need. Mm-hmm. I look at Mayari now and she looks at me the same way. She's like, Poppy, you're perfect. Like, you are everything I need you to be right now. And so I'm like, yeah, Kate creates that space for me. And that's why I try to create space for her. Like, like you're talking about, you can just sit with Alma, nothing happening, just be there. This studio that I'm in, I want to make that reading nook for her so that she doesn't have to watch TV or do something in the other room. Cause I'm like, well, I gotta edit. Like, this is my passion right now, is this podcast. and I want her to be here next to me while I work on it. And she's watching her scary movies. Because she's watching her scary movies, I don't have to focus on the TV. I can keep focusing on the show. But yeah, Kate, I love you, and I'm just so thankful. And I know you will see this, and I will most likely share this on social media now that you are on back on social media sharing stuff. I want the whole world. I love this. I love you so much for giving me this confidence to, we got a full damn show. Like, and I stopped referring to it as a podcast. Like, you have given me the confidence to have a show. I got a show.
They got a whole TV show.
Yeah. I don't know if podcasts get awards like our man Lamorne winning an Emmy. I don't know if we get Emmys, but God damn it. I want an award now.
I think they do have like a podcast
podcast category, something like that.
Yeah, we just got to figure out what niche category we're in. But yeah, we'll win some awards soon. No, but Kate,
I'm gonna look into it.
I want to say something to Kate, and then I'm gonna say something to my wife. Kate, you have given, and I think I've seen it through the time that we've become friends, and then also the time that we've become partners in this journey together. You have, your confidence has grown a lot. The way that you deliver things to the podcast, and the production meetings, and the way that you have taken ownership of your voice, more than just being your friend De'Meco. I think that all that comes from the conversations you and Kate have at the crib. So shout out to Kate for, again, making that space safe and also allowing you to be vulnerable, because a lot of men can't be vulnerable around their partners, which leads to terrible, terrible relationships. So you guys are doing it solid. And my niece is watching me on TV a lot, so I can't help but be
proud. Uncle Bill.
To say I'm Uncle Bill. But no, same thing as Z. Like, without that girl saying that I could spend the night, instead of going back to my place, one for her, one for you, I would not be, I think I'm dope, but I wouldn't be as dope as I am right now. The ways that my wife has allowed me to be wrong in situations, but she allows me to be wrong, and then she helps me see the errors in my way. Not saying that she's correcting me, but I will go on a tangent about some shit. She's like, all right, but that's a very, that's one way of seeing it. And, you know, so like now that's how I carry myself in every conversation. It's like, oh, that's one way you can see that. So the way I am with my daughter and the way I am with my child's mom is 1,000% your fault. And I appreciate you for that. So I love you to death, bro. Love you to the moon and back, Z. Yeah. Right now, gentlemen, if you are listening to this, if you've gotten to this point in the podcast and you do have that significant other, that partner that allows you to be great, pause this or play this as loud as you can for them. Without you ladies, we are nothing. Without you people, without our partners, we as fathers are nothing. So thank you all so much. We appreciate you.
All right, we gonna have one more video, and this can either be in the episode, because I know we went on some tangents that might cut out how short this episode is.
I think we walked a little bit. Walked a little bit. Yeah.
Do you ever notice that when you hug your children, you're the first to let go? Daddy's got to go to work now.
That's a hard lesson.
I always hug them, and then I do the 1, 2, 3 pat on their back, like I'm done.
Like a wrestling match.
Totally. I hug them, and I hug them with so much love. And I literally am like thinking of my heart. How much love am I going to pour into you right now in this moment? Because you are all that matters. The shift. Whoa.
Yeah.
The length of the hug.
Henry starts at 7:15 and ends at 8:12. Totally. Let them be the ones who break.
Noticeably longer, these hugs. Two more minutes is not going to be the end of the world.
For as long as you need.
I saw that video And I was, I think it brought me back to when Mayari was just born and I finished like my first little stint of paternity leave. And I was obviously, I knew I had to go to work. And I was like, I'm not in a rush to go to work. I was like, man, I don't really want to go. Like, I've spent all this time with Mayari. I don't want to leave. But then you kind of get lost in your everyday. Like, I got to go to work. I got to get this promotion. I got to do whatever it is. And you kind of phone it in, so to speak. Like, all right, I'm a hug. And then I got to go. Like, I don't know when it happened. It might have been when we started this podcast, to be honest, where I just started recognizing, like, ain't nothing bigger than the relationship I have with my daughter. So like that point of let your child be the one to end the hug. And we talk about this, like we talked about it earlier, of like Penelope or Mayari growing into new stages where they're not going to want to hug as long, or they're going to move out of the house and start their own family. Like you will long for those hugs to last a little bit longer. At this point, there's no reason as parents for us to cut that short. The time with our children is short enough, you know, like as their children, you know, like I'm never going to cut another hug short. If there were, I think probably a couple months ago. Well, no, I think a couple months ago, because the summer was a blur living in Wisconsin before that. Before Wisconsin, I remember there was a day when I was getting ready to go to work and Mayari just kept crying, like, and saying, Papa, Papa, up, up. And I was like literally just trying to get out of the door. And I was like, man, fuck this. I'm staying home. Like, yeah, she still went to daycare, but I'm like, that gives me an extra hour with her. Mm-hmm. I'm like, it's not that important to go to work. I have the flexibility to do so. Then why not utilize it? Yeah. That's huge. I think about that all the time now. It's just like, yeah, like we're never not dead, but that our baby's going to grow up and she's not going to want to be held. And I just, yeah, I'm never going to end a hug with her ever.
So I still pick Penelope up, and she's like, as I'm 6'1" and a half, Penelope is at my belly button, the top of her head. I still carry her as much as I can. She hates it. The only place I don't pick her up at is when we're at, yeah, for sure. I know she does. But like I told her, like, I'm going to hold you, hug you, carry you as long as I can, as long as I physically can, until you get to a point where you're like, all right, my nigga, like, this is weird.
Now you the weird one. You the weird kid.
Hey, Dad. People are making fun of me because you carry me everywhere.
I just don't want my baby to touch the ground.
But no, like, I carry cousins everywhere I go. Like, and hugs here at the house, they're, like, she gets love. And I think that's one thing that I can say my mother did as well. Like, my mom was a goofy mom when she needed to be, or, like, when she wanted to be. She gave us love. She always showed us that she cared. Like, always gave us, like, all right, y'all, good night. Like, good night kisses on the forehead, good night hugs. Like, that was, like, a routine. So, like, those things I've always loved, always wanted to do. So I do that with cuz every night. Anytime she's here, or I'll give her a call or send her a text, like, in the morning or at night. Hey, love you, bro. Have a good day at school. Hey, love you, shorty. Have a good night. Night-night. Talk to you in the morning. Or how was your day? All those things. So the conversations, those things, like, are there. But when she's here, and I know that she wants that physical touch as well, because she's like, Daddy, let's fight. Or, Daddy, hey, Daddy, there's something on your bed. Can I show you? And I'm like, oh, what is it? And she was like, trying to, like a Sonko stunner, or like the rock bottom on me. She's like, let me try a chokeslam. I'm like, you're not a chokeslam. And then, so, like, we just, like, start fighting in the room. So there's moments in time where I'm like, I know that my child is yearning for this. So until she stops wanting to play with me, I'm not going to stop giving her the long hugs. I'm not going to 1, 2, 3 pat her in the back and like, oh, we're done hugging. Or I think this is a good time to hug. Or like the people are like, I'll stop kissing my kids. Like, all right, so yeah, as a grown-ass fucking person, you probably shouldn't kiss your child on the mouth, because you'd be doing grown-ass person things. But to kiss my kid, I'm going to kiss my daughter on the forehead until the day I pass away.
So I saw your story, and obviously at the time of the recording, we now have a date here, so you know when this was. Two kids, huh?
That's just wild. I don't know about that.
Same.
I don't know about that. That's just wild. That's wild to think about. Like, and it's wild for me too, because like, peep this. Penelope's about to be nine. She'll be nine next year. So not even about to be, like, it's a damn near a year away.
She just turned eight. Updated the
We just updated the below box for your boy. So Cud just turned eight. So next year she'll be nine, right? Is that a good time to go back into the well of infancy, toddler, like terrible twos, threes, toddler, elementary school, middle school, all over again? Not the only, because I have baby fever like crazy. I would have 12 kids if I could. The only thing that's holding me back is that thought. But what keeps me going is like, I don't want to be selfish and not give my wife that opportunity or option to be a mom 100% of her own. Like, she's a perfect bonus mom. But I want cuz, like, if she wants to go through that mom journey, like, I want her to be able to go through that shit by herself, like, and not have to enjoy somebody else's kid. Like, you want your own toy, let's have your own toy. That's probably a bad way to say that.
I get what you're saying. I mean, it's an oversimplification, but yeah, it's understandable. Like, you want your own. Like, yeah, I get that. Kate and I were obviously we're always talking about it, and I think at this moment in time, we haven't ruled it. We're struggling with making a definitive no, but we think we're leaning that way. Obviously, we're looking at it as a holistic thing of it's expensive, it's time consuming, it's going through the pregnancy again, the infancy, the body changes, and just, but then we talked about it the first episode of this season, anxiety kind of rearing its ugly head in my life as a dad. Well, that's going to be tenfold with a second child. And now it's no longer 2v1. It's one-on-one. Like,
you guys are running man defense now.
Exactly. And so there is no break. And so to think, and Kate and I talked about this, like, life doesn't happen in a vacuum. So we would have to assume that the stress and strain that our relationship goes through will be amplified with the addition of another child, because at the end of the day, that child can't provide for themselves, so we have to step up. That takes away from something, and I'm all, yo, Patrick, shout out you for putting that on my, a yes is always a no to something else, and that is in my head at all times. And it sounds selfish depending on how you look at it, but I just refuse to tell my daughter no. Like, one of Kate's friends has two kids, recently has had their second kid, and their oldest child is like, "Mommy, I miss that you don't put me to bed as much." And I was like, damn. Yeah. If Mayari hit me with that, I'm like, I don't know. Like, I'm like, and so I take that so seriously. I'm like, I don't ever want to take anything away from her. And I get it, like, having an additional sibling, and like, there is that. And Kate, like, you had talked about it, like, if when Alma goes, like, you're not far after that. Like, Kate and I, we got a death pack. Like, I don't want to know a world without Kate in it, and vice versa. But at the end of the day, like, I'm not going to just unalive myself. I'm like, I got a whole daughter that still needs me around, and vice versa. But I was like, oh, like, that's a plus of having a sibling, is that Mayari won't be alone. And that's always big. That's another thing. I'm like, that's I'm like, I don't want Mayari to be alone. Cause yeah, we've got extended family, but they hella extended right now. You know, like, they ain't really, in, like, you are the best uncle and you ain't really an uncle, but, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and that's a problem. And so I don't ever want Mayari to feel that way. And so that's leans us towards that, hey, we're gonna have another child. I wonder though, because obviously we're both girl dads. I want to see what a mini me looks like. Not looks like, but like, I know the lessons that I teach Mayari will prepare her to be the person that she's meant to be.
Yeah.
But like, I wonder if I can make a better version of me. Because Mayari is her own person, because I've never met anyone like her. But if we were to have a son, it would be hard as a father not to see yourself in your son, you know? And so like, you're always wanting your son. And I always think about how my dad talked to me. He's like, I want my son to be better than me and all that stuff, like, and give them the tools to do that. And I was like, yeah, I don't know. And you see Mayari. I mean, she's cute as a button. Could you imagine a little boy like that, as cute as that? Oh, hell no.
The white man. The white man.
You can't ever say the word nigga, ever.
But also... I'm sorry. I'm going to be bad.
But also,
shoot so many people for you. I'd have to fight
for like, you. But like, genetically, what if he came out dark?
Complete opposite. And it's like, oh my gosh.
I don't.
Dude, yeah, that would be wow. You know what? Have a kid. I'm gonna see what this is like now. Nigga, I'm playing like
now it's just life. An experiment. Yeah, now it's just an experiment. But yeah, it's interesting to think about the idea of having a second child and what that adds and what that takes away from. Yeah, it's difficult. It's a difficult conversation. Yeah, it's an additional mouth to feed. That's a whole lot of things. But then I knowing that I was going to bring this up to you, I was like, yeah, I mean, he can't tell Alma like, hey, no, you can't be a mom. Like, no, nah, like, yeah. she has the right to be a mom to her own child. And I know she's a great bonus mom to Penelope. But I like, if that's something she wants, I know you'll give it to her. And then I'm like, all right, well, then you're still a father of two. Yeah, you're still a father of two. Like, yeah, this is Alma's first child, and you'll be going through that again from that perspective. But yeah, you're still a father of two, and still figuring out what that means. And I almost think having them that far apart, you're not really taking away in the sense from Penelope, because she's grown, you know, like
a built-in babysitter, nigga.
Yeah, like she's doing
exactly what she's gonna be. Penelope, get in there and feed your little brother, little sister, cause daddy's gotta go do a podcast. You take care of the house, nigga. I trained you right. Go out there, Milan, do your job. My daughter is my Milan.
Yeah, she's about to like be in all the extracurriculars and all that stuff. Like, she's got her own stuff going on. Yeah. So like, there is no set.
She's carving her own path. So I think in a sense it is good if we were to try and have a kid now, or if her parents or her mom and Ryan, which y'all definitely should, because that would be a cute ass baby. And you already know, if y'all have the baby, that's bonus dad Blair.
It's a village right there.
Like, you know, I'm not even really a bonus dad, but I'm like the extra nigga that's there at the crib. You know what I'm saying? But
in all sense of the word, you are that extra nigga, because that is a white family.
I'm just
the nigga. Nigga.
I'm in a sitcom. I'm like, it's you and me and me and you and you and me and your friend Steve. That is me. I'm Steve. But no, it's like if her parents were to want to do that, or if we were wanting to do that, it would just be beneficial for all of us, because Penelope is carved out in her own lane. She does have things that she's doing on her own. And it's not like she has to beg for attention. Like, if Alma is doing something, I don't need to be watching Alma be with our baby. Like, it would be beautiful, because like, of course I would love to be there for every moment, but I also have one that's 8 or 9 or whatever the age should be. So I got to be able to feed into her still too. And vice versa. So like, if Alma still wants to be bonus mom and like still wants to go crazy with Goose, I'm all right, nigga. I've done this before. I got 10 years experience. Nigga, give me that baby. Hand that motherfucker off. Give me the PO. Yeah. Give me the PO, coach. I got it. And dad of the year. That's what be on. But no, it's still a daily conversation. Do we have a kid? Do we do this? And I'm on board with whatever my wife wants to do. The second she says yeah, I'm down. The second she says no, I'm gonna have to get a drink, but I'll be down.
I think I'm in that same boat. We would obviously have to get the green light from the doctors from a health standpoint. Obviously,
that's the biggest thing.
It's just like, yeah, we take the conversation seriously. And I think it almost feels like as a parent, how you talk to people that don't have kids, like that's how it feels like when people with multiple kids be like, oh, so when are you going to try have another? I'm like, in this economy, are you crazy? Like this is like my man Blair said, season one. It's called a relationship. This ain't no cruise. Get the fuck out my get the fuck out my boat.
Why are you trying to get out my boat?
Yeah, this. there's only enough space for two bodies on this door. Okay, from Titanic. I'm looking at you, Rose.
Yeah, you dirty, filthy wench.
Leo out here freezing to death.
Oh man, she could have legit switched spots with Cubs. That's fucked up.
Speaking of that. How you feeling about our man, D Rose, hanging it up?
Shout out to Pooh. I love you, bro.
What a career. What a career.
I love Pooh. I love Pooh on more than one level, bro. Like, he's a. Pooh's a dope ass dude. Put on for the city. I grew up around Cuz. Knew him, knew of him, hooped around him, and that whole AAU circuit. Bro was nice.
You, I would imagine you would rank him top Chicago athlete.
Yeah.
Born and bred from the city. From the city.
Yeah. He did everything every Chicago athlete ever thought about doing. We all, if you hoop, your dream was to be able to play for the Bulls and take over for what Jordan did. You wanted to be the guy from the city to carry on the flag. He got to live that dream. The reason Isaiah Thomas hates Michael Jordan and vice versa is because Isaiah Thomas wanted the love that Michael Jordan got in Chicago. He just played for Detroit. Zay's from the West Side. Like, Rose is from, he's from Roseland Park. Like,
yeah, Inglewood is what I saw.
Inglewood. He's really one of them ones, bro. So to come from where we come from in that area to then go to Memphis for a year, kill at Memphis, get drafted number one to your city. Bro, youngest MVP, most athletic one guard that has ever touched the ball. Like, yeah.
I saw something on ESPN that talked about like Anthony Edwards and like the basically like the Rose clause as far as like a contract of a rookie outplaying their rookie contract as far as expectation that allows them to get an extra 30-40% bump in their next contract because of how outstanding Derrick Rose was his rookie year.
Well, I'm not gonna believe it. Like he.
Yeah.
Not generational because that's like overplayed, but I think pure Hooper. Hooper's Hooper. You roll the ball out, I'm going to get you a bucket. I'm not going to dance on you. I'm not going to shoot a three. I'm going to try and take your face off at the rim. I'm going to get mine. Him, D-Wade, Amon Shumpert, Evan Turner.
Evan Turner getting love. Oh, shit.
Yeah, bro, because for real, bro's nice. Like, bro's really nice. Like, to make it out of the West Side and go to Ohio State and get drafted top 10, top 5, like, Evan Turner's nice, bro. Like, he just can't shoot the three ball. That's it. That's why people think he's a bum. But look at him when he played for the 76ers. Mid-range game, him and Andre Iguodala, mid-range to the rim, crazy work. D-Wade, one of the top three two guards in the NBA history, and he didn't utilize a three-point shot. crazy work. That's GOAT status. That's South Side Chicago, West Side Chicago. Like,
so if you had to, if you had to have a starting five, Chicago born and raised, or maybe not Chicago, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, because I know, I think like KG kind of claimed Chicago.
Yeah, he went to high school in Chicago. Patrick Beverly, actually, so like, from the West Side.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. If you had to make a starting five,
D Rose at one, D Wade at the two. I'm gonna say Benji at the three. God rest his soul.
Benji.
I'm about to start crying thinking about Benji. Benji at the three, KG at the four, and then AD at the five.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
That's a solid lineup.
Can you say Shot City? I'm coming home again.
How many games do you think they win in a season?
I don't know, bro.
82?
AD's going to be injured. AD's going to be injured. D-Rose might have a bad knee here or there.
I'm thinking D-Wade prime. I'm thinking prime.
Okay. Prime. So that's Anthony prime. Davis in New Orleans. That's Kevin Garnett in Minnesota. That's Evan Turner in the 76ers. That's D-Wade in Miami and Rose winning the MVP. Shit. Depending on who y'all talking about. Depending on what you are, we might got like, hey, you might have
who's the coach? Who's the coach?
Hey, me.
Didn't Doc, nigga, come out of Chicago?
Yeah, Doc Rivers came out of Chicago. We'll give him that. But no, Doc, like we said when we got our guests, and like we said on every podcast episode, we literally could be talking for the next like 2.5 hours because I think we were going to keep thinking about shit to talk about. But I just looked at my clock. It's 8 o'clock. We gotta go. So with that being said, I'm your play partner, host of the Monster Country Cousin Blair, aka Sir Winnie. This is my brother De'Meco, the light skinned demon. Big as the what? What if Kendrick comes out to the Super Bowl with that song? Like that, like that's how he starts the Super Bowl. Just him coming out like big as the what? And then Lil Wayne comes out and is like, I see dead people.
I think you just wrote the script. Did you see the script?
I didn't.
Did you see the script?
Don't come for me. I saw no scripts. So with that being said, we love you guys, man. Make sure you hit the like, share, subscribe button. Leave a comment down below on who you think the best Chicago athlete is. We'd love to see that shit. That's dope as hell. So yeah, make sure you tell somebody that you love them because we love you. Love you guys, man. Peace.
Peace.